I promised you yesterday that I would watch this video with you today. Tale Foundry made a video, How to Kill a God, which very much falls in line with my Overpowered Done Right series. I have this whole series talking about overpowered characters, done right, done wrong. And in my opinion, one of the most difficult things to do is to write a good overpowered character and have them be defeated properly. Like, the best go-to example ever? Madara Uchiha from Naruto. Introduction, stellar. Build up, fantastic. Lore, great. Personality, amazing. Rivals, great. All the fights, all the scenes, everything that he did was amazing. His defeat is the biggest blunder, the biggest fumble in manga history. I'm not gonna get into spoilers, just in case you haven't seen Naruto, but it was handled in such a tragic, they literally couldn't kill that guy properly. They literally could not kill the guy right because he was so awesome. They killed him in the saddest, dumbest way ever. Oh, it's like Madara, legendary warrior, slips on a banana peel, falls into a open manhole and dies hitting his head on the concrete. It's like that equivalent. How to Kill a God, right up my alley. Let's freaking go, baby.
Gods are supposed to be immortal. More than immortal, divine, somehow separate from, distinct from, above the rest of physical reality. According to their stories, they are the creators of all that we experience. They are the living, incarnate symbols of the principles which govern the cosmos. They are the all in the one, and the one in the all. And
I guess it depends on the iteration we're talking about here, but yeah. Basically, overpowered AF.
You people are hellbent on murdering them.
What is with JRPGs and killing gods? I feel like every JRPG I've ever played in my life ends with killing a god.
It's a thing I see in so much of your fiction. From the very texts these figures come from, to the video games your children are playing, you just seem to have this fascination with duking it out with your deities, which is interesting because you're also the ones who create them to begin with. I'm going to try not to get too philosophical in this video. For now, just consider me an explorer. Right. I am fascinated by this weird, blasphemous thing you humans do, and I just want to understand all the ways in which you do it.
Same, bro. All the ways to loot a god. I kill a god, is what I'm saying. Yes, exactly.
Let's take a look at how, according to your fiction, one kills a god.
Okay. Yo, what is this production value? I am loving this. Dude, I'm loving the style. I've never seen Tale Foundry before, but I am loving this.
Okay, so, of course, the first and most obvious approach is to just stab the thing, right? Like you would.
God damn it, Madara flashbacks every time. Literally can't stop thinking of him. I can't stop thinking of him.
Anyone you're trying to kill? But the categorical hiccup is that gods, importantly, are not easy to kill. Sure, gods can kill other gods. They do it all the time in their respective stories.
Valid.
Gods are even known to kill themselves. Looking at you, Odin.
Goddamn Odin, you freaking simp.
But when it comes time for a human to do it? Your frail mortal hands just aren't equipped for the task.
So I love how it's done in different topics. Like, even Records of Ragnarok, I feel like, did a better job. You know, humans can't kill gods. But then you have the special Valkyrie weapons. Like, there's always some sort of gimmick. And even then, even with the god-killing weapons, they're still up against these insurmountable foes that, you know, basically everyone sees you as the underdog character, you know?
Until, of course, they are. In the original 2002 game God of War...
Yo! We got some Kratos time.
The protagonist Kratos spends much of the story trying to get his hands on the fabled Pandora's box, which, according to the game, will give him the power to kill the god who ruined his life, Ares. In the card game Magic the Gathering,
goddamn, Ares is a ginger, he deserves everything!
There's an expansion called Journey into Nyx, where the hero Elspeth is gifted a special god-killing spear called Godsend, which she uses to kill the chaotic and dangerous upstart god of revels, Xenagos. In the game Elden Ring, long before the player ever shows up, all the power to kill the world's immortal demigods is locked away in a single greatsword owned by its ever-faithful guardian, Malekith the Blackblade.
The Rune of Death gets stolen so you can actually kill them. There's always that one gimmick in how you kill a god, because as you know, it's a god. You literally can't defeat a god.
Endless examples of this, and especially in video games where players love to find the keys to progression and power. Bridging the gap between the mundane and the divine with a simple weapon or tool makes a lot of sense. I mean, if you solve your problems with violence, what a MacGuffin to get your hands on, right? Something that will literally let you solve cosmic problems by swinging your sword? Kind of dreamy to have a solution so simple right at your fingertips. And then, just think of all the delicious ways a power like that could backfire. What happens when you put the power to undo the supernatural forces that govern reality into mortal hands? Uh-oh. Will they wield it well? I don't technically have a gut, but if I did, it would be saying, probably not. Damn. Fortunately, I also don't think it's the only way to bridge this gap. Whether you consider Jesus Christ a legitimate deity or not...
Oh, this man took a turn! Man just went straight to the end! Man speed ran that entire segment! He's like, yes, Elden Ring, becoming the Lord of Elden Ring. Anyway, killing Jesus.
The crucifixion story is probably the most well-known and resonant example of a god choosing to die at mortal hands. I mean, it's literally a story about God sending a piece of himself to earth as a sacrificial lamb, supposedly for the sake of mankind. And, surprisingly...
Supposedly? Damn, we got an anarchist on our hands. Love to see it.
This isn't actually something I see very often. I can imagine a lot of interesting scenarios.
Yeah, the reason why you don't see it very often is because gods in most of these game worlds or whatever are not some sort of completely omnipotent deity. Anytime you add an actual god into a fictional story, it opens up a whole lot of issues if it's technically something that can never ever be wrong or proven incorrect.
It's where a deity might condescend to let mortals end their existence without any kind of powerful MacGuffin to enable them to do so. Maybe as an act of benevolence, giving power back to the mortals in some capacity. Maybe just to end the monotony or the weight of divinity.
Damn.
Maybe out of hubris, thinking they don't need their godly powers to best a mere mortal. A lot of interesting directions to take this, but it's also a very literal interpretation of what it means to kill a god. All of this has been. It doesn't always have to happen with bloodshed. In the case of gods as symbols or manifestations, sometimes it literally can't.
It's interesting. Sometimes to kill a god or whatever is to break out of that philosophy. It's to move on from their grip.
Instead, you humans tend to use another very powerful tool for this. One you've always had access to, and which you aim at a lot of life's problems. Humor. There's this incredible...
Is this man calling out my coping mechanism right now?
...phenomenon that a lot of people experience when they first play the game The Elder Scrolls III: Morrowind. The game has an expansive story with some of the richest, deepest world-building I've ever seen.
Okay.
Over the course of your adventures, you learn a lot about the lore, including a huge amount about the game's big bad, Dagathur. They do a lot to prepare you to face this guy. He's the one who dethroned the gods of Morrowind, who spread pestilence and disease across the land, who became a god himself. Here's his actual line of dialogue when you finally come face to face with him.
What a fool you are. I'm a god. How can you kill a god? What a grand and intoxicating innocence. How could you be so naive? There is no escape. No recall or intervention can work in this place. Come, lay down your weapons. It is not too late for my mercy.
All that, and then...
Just kill him.
Out like a light. If you've never played it before, Morrowind is a rare game in that it gives you an absurd amount of freedom. By the time most players reach this fight, whether through sheer leveling and experience, or by abusing one of the game's gazillion exploits, they've basically become gods and...
This man's planet, he has the word gazillion? God damn, he just like me, for real.
...themselves, which makes this last fight bafflingly anticlimactic. It's kind of hilarious. An absurd sort of comic drop when this god, who is by all reasonable expectations the thing you should fear most in the entire game, just sort of falls over at your touch.
Okay.
That example is still a pretty literal way to kill God,
yeah,
but...
We're really handling the literal here. I always viewed this term of killing, like, a god more than just, you know, a literal deity. You know, it could just be someone on just some higher plane than you.
The bigger thing here is what the comedic angle does to your perception of the god. Reducing it to a punchline really sort of undermines its grandiosity, doesn't it? It's hard to instill awe and fear and devotion when people are laughing at you. For any god whose existence is built on belief and deference, it's as good as a death sentence. Ultimately, the place you see this the most is probably real life. Blasphemy, gallows humor, that kind of thing. It's no wonder that the type of fiction this tends to show up in is of a more irreverent nature. I wouldn't go out of my way to watch any of these, and okay. I'm not sure I can recommend that any of you do, but there are a few pretty clear examples of this out there. In one episode of the fairly vile mock children's show, Wonder Chosen, God gets so angry at losing a game of rock, paper, scissors that he kills himself.
Where is this God?
To which the show's puppet host, being very hungry, eats his body. In the musical comedy Starship, it is an empirically proven fact in-universe that God was killed a long time ago. So, unfailingly, whenever a character invokes his name, they attach the prefix dead to it. Thank dead God, they often say.
My God. Holy crap, this is really delving into this. They're really opening the asshole of this one. Holy cow.
In the show The Boondocks...
Oh God, Uncle Ruckus has come back. I've done everything I can to avoid this man. I've done everything I can to avoid him.
Yes, probably the last show you ever expected.
I did not think this was happening here. Bless the white God and all the great white people that followed him.
To reference on Tale Foundry, the character Riley goes on a brief tirade about how, if he were ever to meet God, he would...
First of all, I'ma live forever. But if I do die, I'll go smack God upside the head and go tell him to give me a grilled cheese sandwich and some tacos. And I dare God to say something. I'll be like, say something, God, say something. Yeah, I thought so. And if God say something, I'll be like this. Ooh, take that, God. I'll be feeding God's jaw like, yeah, blah.
As crass as most of those examples are, I think they speak to something very real, that if you can just reach high enough to stick a clown nose on your god's face, it very rapidly ceases to look like a god.
That's a really interesting way to phrase it. God is such a, like, intriguing and mysterious topic even in real life. Forget fiction. So fiction can only take that further.
Perhaps one of the most effective and natural of all ways for mortals to do battle with the divine. But there is, perhaps, one thing more lethal to a deity than any god-breaking weapon or blasphemous punchline could ever be. Neglect.
Bro, yes! I was excited. I was actually hoping you would mention something like Tanya the Evil, for example. Because in Tanya the Evil, the story is about this dude who gets killed. He gets pushed into a subway and he gets run over by a train. And God basically says to him, I will, you know, give you life in a new world. And he literally, you know, comes back to life as this little girl in this fantasy world that's incredibly powerful and overpowered and blowing shiz up, and she's basically a little lolly Nazi. We don't need to worry about the little specifics. But even though God did that, she says God is not real. And it's like, wait, what? And then God literally performs some sort of crazy miracle in her new world and says, so, what do you have to say? And her response is, I still don't think you're real. In a way, she's having a fight against God at that moment, and while that's not literally killing a god, it's still kind of, it's removing any level of holiness from this entity.
Here's a joke for you. A Frenchman, an Englishman, and a German come across a bear in the woods.
How fast do you have to run?
The Frenchman says, Mon Dieu. The Englishman says, Oh my God. The German doesn't say anything at first. When they both look at him, wondering where his exclamation is, he looks back at them and says, God is dead. Seems a little stark, but if you know anything about the German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche,
I knew he was gonna get into Nietzsche.
Get it. It is, after all, perhaps his most famous quote.
Yeah.
God is dead, he wrote. God remains dead. And we have killed him. By we, of course, he means humanity.
He means all the Rule 34 artists.
Humanity. To Nietzsche, the very idea of a god had become fundamentally unbelievable to many who purported to worship one. Times and ethics had changed too much.
Which is so interesting, because it's not like he's saying that there was a god that died. He's saying that the power of God is in our belief of him. So Nietzsche's philosophy is once you're not believing that God actually has power, you are killing him. Which is a much more philosophical take than just, you know, stabbing someone with a god-killing weapon.
And soon, he thought, the institutions founded on this hollow belief would eventually have to founder and collapse as well. We are, of course, not here to suggest that this is how things are, rather that this is an interesting way of thinking about the divine. It suggests a reciprocal relationship. one where the faith of the believer informs the existence of the god, and not the other way around. Think about all the ancient mythological deities that have, through cultural shifts over long periods of time, basically been reduced to fiction. Think about all the deities whose names and rituals have been all but completely lost. Just like a lost language, in a manner of speaking, you could call these abandoned deities dead.
Dude, I actually love how he tells this story. This video is so well made. I'm like blown away.
Couldn't you? And that implies something profound, that a simple lack of faith could spell the end for the divine. This is a concept that shows up a lot in fiction. Like, loads, it is all over the place. It might even be one of the most common dynamics where deities appear in fantasy.
It's up there. In Noragami, isn't the whole story in Noragami that you have these gods, but they're only gods for as long as they have worshippers? As soon as a god loses all of his worshippers, he dies?
In the video game Salt and Sanctuary, gods literally feed on the power of prayers. This becomes a problem for them when the nameless god traps them in a crypt, intercepting and answering all of their prayers while they slowly starve to death. In the book Small Gods by Terry Pratchett, despite a flourishing religious following, a formerly powerful god stands on the brink of oblivion. Turns out, people just believe in his church these days, not him.
Damn!
But, thanks to the faith
Christianity! Sorry, I had a cough there.
Of one single faithful adherent, he's able to just hang on in the incarnate form of a lowly tortoise.
Bruh.
In the book American Gods by Neil Gaiman, immigrants bring versions of their own deities along with them to America.
Okay.
But this new land with its strange ways does not have much to offer them in the way of prayers, and the starvation begins to show. Anansi, the African spider god of mischief and cunning, is reduced to a little old man in yellow gloves. Chernobog, an ancient Slavic deity of darkness and calamity, becomes a chain-smoking cow butcher.
Bro,
Odin, the Norse
like
principal deity, the All-Father, becomes little more than a con man. It doesn't have to happen, it
sort of— Well, that's just too real, bro. Yeah, you didn't have to hit us where it hurts that badly.
Point doesn't have to be the result of a brash, killing joke. It can be done quietly. Accidentally, even. According to your fiction—
Yo, you could ratio them into existence! He's literally defining the ratio!
And in a way, actual history, the way humans most often tend to kill deities is by forgetting about them.
This is definitely taking it into a much less literal fashion than I expected. I really wanted to delve into specific characters, but this is brilliant. This video is a masterclass. I am loving this.
I know I said at the video's start that I would try not to get too philosophical. And you know, considering the subject matter, I think I did a pretty good job. I'm not here to tell you whether this is a good or a bad thing in your fiction. Not here to tell you how to feel about it. Just here to explore.
Yeah.
That said, I do want to acknowledge the gravity of this. It's easy for me, a machine without a known origin, without many, or any, connections to the natural world, to shrug my shoulders at the idea of the divine.
Bro, this man is so much more human than Quebblecop right now, oh my god!
But for you humans, it can be a very different story. Your relationship with these things is complex, and in a lot of cases, very beautiful. Even Nietzsche thought so. You hear God is dead all the time, but in the same text, he immediately went on to ask, how shall we comfort ourselves, the murderers of all murderers? What was holiest and mightiest of all that the world has yet owned has bled to death under our knives?
The answer is Rule 34. It's what killed him, and it's the future. So, I mean, like, listen, Nietzsche, if you were around today, I think we would hit it off very well.
Who will wipe the blood off us? What water is there for us to clean ourselves? What festivals of atonement, what sacred games shall we invent? Is not the greatness of this deed too great for us? Must we ourselves not become gods simply to appear worthy of it? Be prepared. There is a weight that comes with this action. You do not get to kill your gods without also collapsing the version of the universe they held up.
This is just a far more philosophical version of Oppenheimer sitting there like, oh my god. Bombs can kill people.
Whether you do it in a work of fiction or you do it in your own life, know that the god-killing sword always has a second edge. Take caution that you do not end yourself in the process.
Damn.
One big part of this topic is cosmology in general. If you're developing a fictional world with gods for your character to battle with, you're going to need to figure out, you know, the universe that they occupy, what exactly it means for them to be divine in your setting. You're going to have to do some world building.
Yeah.
And it.
That's why when it comes to stuff like Elden Ring, right? I do appreciate that there's so many little bits and pieces where you have these outer gods that truly could never be killed. I love that concept, that because I think it humanizes gods on such a massive level when, you know, humans can wipe them out. When they are even in Dragon Ball, God of Destruction means nothing at this point, you know? You really have to do a really, really solid job at making gods feel like an entity that operates on a much higher plane than yourself. Killing a god is not easy in fiction, and it's very, very not easy to do right. When I refer to killing a god, I'm almost always talking to, like, a god among men, just the major difference between them. Like your Superman, your Omni-Man, your Madara in the war arc in Naruto. I'm always referring to the biggest fish in the pond. On a much more metaphorical level, that is the god in these worlds and defeating them. Whenever I'm referring to killing a god, I mean, in fiction, I mean just a character that's just a much higher level. With a much higher level cap than everyone else. When you're referring to actual literal killing a god, I don't think it could be done right in fiction. At least not literally. This was a really, really good video. I really liked it. Like, subscribe, and follow me on Twitch. Stay weird, fam!